Hello and welcome to Mayhem with your host, Maymay.
Hi there. I know it's been a few weeks, but I was getting my whole new order up and going. We were talking about starting a new podcast with my idea, but basically it just comes down to the other podcast. We want it to be more similar to a church service, and we're probably not even going to do a podcast for it. We'll probably do it live. So this one, I'm just going to take the format that I was going to use for that podcast and just use it here, which means I have the next year planned for this podcast, which is so exciting for me because now I have a plan. And now I can go through with my plan and give you guys kind of a glimpse into my crazy head. So what I did was I took each month of the year and I gave it something to focus on. So June, we're mid-June, so June for me was about devotion and being able to find the time to worship, being able to find the time to continue your journey with God. And devotion can be every Sunday you're very responsible and go to church all the time, or it could be every morning you pray, or you meditate, or every evening before bed you just say your gratitudes, or it could be anything like that. But just finding that moment, that time to just pause your life and just be in the moment, be present, God, Jesus, whatever, finding the time to just focus on that. Even if you don't believe in God, even if you're just finding the time to be in tune with the moment and be in tune with yourself and be in tune with your breath, that's all devotion. And so the first week of June was going to be about momentum. So after you start something, you have to gain the momentum to continue it. And there's normally typically two parts of momentum. After you begin, there's a piece of momentum that brings you to the middle. And then after the middle is about complete, there's a piece of momentum that brings you to the end because you can see the end in sight. And kind of working through that momentum and trying to continue the momentum for as long as possible. And then I was going to talk about the middle, which is always the hardest part. It's you've diminished your momentum, you've started it, and now you just have to maintain the doldrums of the process to get through to the next step, to get through to the next day, to get through. And so this week, I wanted to talk about finding time. If you're like me, you are super busy, you can have kids, you can be a parent, you can go to work, you can have all these things that you have that are obligations on your table that you have to process and you have to do every day. And sometimes it can be hard to look at your life and all of the things that you have to do and be able to find the time to devote to being present in your life, to prayer, to gratitude, to anything. It's super hard to find a moment to be like, okay, I'm going to focus on my breath. I'm going to focus on what I'm grateful for. I'm going to focus on this prayer. I'm going to focus on together time. I'm going to focus on this one, you know, story that I want to focus on, whatever. It's super hard to find this time, and so I want to talk about it. I believe it is always possible to find time. You can reorganize your thinking. You can start a routine. Some people work really, really great with routines. I'm one of those people. If I do not have a routine and if I do not follow it at least 6 days out of the week, I am not happy. Some people really thrive on not having a routine at all. But when you're sitting there and you're like, okay, I want to go to bed in 5 minutes. The show just ended. What do I want to do with these 5 minutes? That's a great time to be like, maybe I'll just focus on a prayer or do a meditation or do something really quick for these 5 minutes just to get me focused on the now. Doesn't have to be long. Dan Harris, who wrote a book, he used to be a newscaster. He wrote a book called 10% Happier. He says it just takes a minute. So if you just find a minute and you find that same minute for 7 days, you're that much closer to being happier. Not happier, 10% happier. Which, you know, it's not asking for the moon, but it's helping. Sometimes when you sit down at your desk, you take 3 breaths. Just focus. Every time you sit down at your desk, you take 3 breaths. It takes less than a minute. Gets you focused. Gets you mindful. It's another trick. But there is always a moment or two that you can find time to your devotion. When I do things, I tend to overdo things. So when I practice my devotion, I get up at 4:30 in the morning because I have two teenagers, I have a fiance, and I love them all to pieces, and they all like being with me and spending time with me, and they all want my attention, and I want to give my attention to my family. So I get up earlier than everybody else in my household so that I can find an hour to devote to myself, to devote to my devotion, to devote to what I do. And then recently I've started meditating for 15 minutes a day, and it doesn't have to be 15 minutes. Some days it's 8. But just to sit down and be like, okay, I'm going to go through this prayer. I'm going to do this mantra. I'm going to sit down and listen to the little voice inside me that I know that's there. Not everybody can do this. Some people, I'm a morning person. I wake up, I am shooting out of bed, I am ready to face my day. Some people are not like that. Some people are ready to face their day at night. Some people might want to stay up an hour after everybody else has gone to bed and focus on their prayer then. It's up to you. But that is another way to do it. I know that Rachel Hollis as well, she says get up a half an hour before everybody else. Use that time for yourself. Same concept. Now, the other step that you need to do is you need to create space. You need to find a space in your home that you can use and you can go to every time. And that gets you moving, that gets you motivated, that gets you thoughtful to your devotion. I have an office. I happen to be one of the lucky people because now that I work from home, I can shut the door. It doesn't work, but it's there. But in my office, I have my desk, and then I have a couple of drawers where I keep my journals. And then I have oracle cards that I pull every week, and I have them set up so that I can look at them every day in this space for me. And then when I meditate, I have a place on the ground that I always sit right next to my beads that I use. And that's where I can sit cross-legged and just be apart. And it's really important for me to have this space. If we move into a smaller house, when we move into a smaller house, even if it's just a corner of a room that I can be alone in, I'm going to cherish that space. Even if it's your desk chair and you have something there that'll bring you back and remind you of what you're doing there, creating the space to have this devotion is almost as important as finding the time for it. And you need to train your body so that you know that when you come into this space with this mentality, that this is what you're doing. That this is how you're going through the process of getting to hear your knowing, your God, your Holy Spirit, whatever you call it. This is how you're getting to the process to be able to hear Him in your life. Every day, I sit down to meditate, and at one point, no matter what, I get a message that's not me saying it, it's from God. And it kind of gives me a direction for the day, a direction for the week, a direction for my life, whatever. It's just something small, something little that I can do, that I can focus on. And that's why I journal for an hour. That's why I meditate, to hear that message. And I have a huge long process to get there. Your process might be a lot smaller. And to start, I recommend a minute to 5 minutes. To start, I recommend writing down every day 3 things that you are grateful for. Because gratitude will get you there faster than anything else, any other tool that I know of. Gratitude will get you to a devotional space, no matter what. So that's where I would start. Get a notebook, and every single day, sit in the same chair and write down 3 things you're grateful for. Could be, I'm grateful that my puppy likes to cuddle with me at night. I'm grateful that my daughter stopped screaming in her room and is now sleeping. I'm grateful that today is Monday and I get to go back to work. Whatever it is. The other thing that I want to mention here is that if you skip a day, if you don't happen to get there, you need to be flexible with yourself. You need to be soft and gentle with yourself. And you don't need to beat yourself up. You are not going to do this every day. That is not possible. I am happy if I get my journaling done 6 days a week. There are some weekends where I can't do my journaling at all. And then I get back to it on Monday, and that's okay. It is okay that you don't do it every day. Try to do it most of the time. Every day is not an expectation that you should ever have. And it's to the point now where if I skip 3 days and I haven't journaled, I am extra bitchy, and you do not want to be around me until I get back into my space. People notice. Maybe not for you, but it takes time and it's a process. You need to practice self-forgiveness. If you put it down for a month and then you get back to it, just be grateful that you're back to it. Don't worry about that month. You couldn't handle it that month. Just get back to it. And self-forgiveness. Nobody else has to know about this. This can be a private thing. Nobody else's business. Whether or not you do it, if you meditate every day, you don't need to tell anybody. This is your thing. This is between you and God. And finding the time to be able to touch your sacredness, that's the important part. It's nobody's business. And I don't even like it when people read my journals, because those are private. And you should feel the same way. So that's my assignment for this week. Find 5 minutes a day to sit in silence or meditate or read a quote and contemplate on what that quote means for your life. Could be a Bible verse, could be a quote from The Art of War. It could be anything. But contemplate that quote. Find time to sit with that quote and decide what that means for your life. Or journal. Write 3 things you're grateful for. Or take a short walk around the block without listening to music, without listening to a podcast. Just take a walk in silence. Find the time to get in touch with your sacredness, with your inner self, with the silence. And try to do that at least 3 to 4 times a week and see how that changes your life. What I want to talk about for books this week is I read a lot of harder to read books. Right now I'm reading How to Be an Antiracist by Ibram Kendi. I have read Eckhart Tolle. I have read a lot of really heavy duty books that take time. I find that every time I read Brené Brown, I can only read a small portion because I have to digest what she says. And a lot of these books that are a lot harder to process and take a lot of thought, I try to read at least 1 chapter every day. That way it's not too hard. I try to contemplate what it says every day. And I would recommend that you do that too, especially right now. Especially right now in the political climate that we're in. It is so important to understand perspectives that are not your own. To understand what other people have gone through that you have not had to face. This book by Ibram Kendi called How to Be an Anti-Racist is one of the most phenomenal books I've ever read because it has opened my mind up to hundreds of years of systemic racism that has been in this country. He doesn't call it systemic racism, I'm sorry. Our history. In this country, our history is people. He takes books that people have written and he quotes them, and it is staggering. And then he tells you how to fight and set your mindset against that. And it is a beautiful book. It is hard to read. It is very deep. It takes time. And I'm only on chapter 10. But it's life-changing. And the next book I'm going to read is by Austin Channing Brown. There's going to be a book that I really want to read Alicia Keys' new book, but two. But these are important people and important fighters and worth listening to, worth sitting down with. As a person who comes from privilege, I'm starting to understand and see instances in my life where racism was very present and very, very active.